In the last class, we were talking about electronic mail, which is one of the most widely used application on the internet. Today we'll be starting our discussion on another very popular application which I am sure all of you are already familiar with. You must have used it in practice, and it is the World Wide Web. Now, this World Wide Web has become so popular that today World Wide Web and internet, they are used synonymously. Sometimes this World Wide Web or www is meant to be referring to internet or vice versa. So this is an impact of the popularity of this www. Now let us see what this World Wide Web actually is. This is of course the latest revolution in the internet scenario. Millions and millions of people are using the World Wide Web today. The main feature of www is that it allows us to share multimedia documents between machines. When we say multimedia, we say document containing text, pictures, audio clips, video, moving objects, animation. So all these things together can be part of the same document, and we can have this kind of multimedia information which is available on a desktop, which has been displayed on a browser, which makes this application so very interesting and attractive. Now, what this World Wide Web actually is? This is basically a huge collection of documents which are interlinked. Interlinked means one document is linked to some other document, this some other document may be linked to some other document. So there can be links between one document and another. You know that when you have a link, you can click it on a mouse, you go to some other document. That is what link means. So these documents are all linked together. Okay? So there are billions of documents, they are linked in all arbitrary possible ways, and since there is a very complicated interconnection of this document using these links, they resemble a cobweb, and from the cobweb this World Wide Web, this term has come. So the name World Wide Web has come from cobwebs. The interlinking among documents is so complex and unstructured, it resembles a cobweb. Okay. Now in www, the documents reside on web servers. Well, what is a web server? Web server is a server which understands hypertext transfer protocol or HTTP. So web servers are also sometimes known as HTTP servers, and the documents which are residing in web servers, they are typically written in a language called hypertext markup language. So they are either written in HTML, or there are some other scripts or programs which can generate an HTML document as the output, which is sent back to the browser. Finally, the browser can receive an HTML document and display it in a suitably formatted way. So the purpose of the browser has the main responsibility to receive these documents and display it in a suitable formatted fashion. There are so many web browsers available today. I have listed some of them: Explorer, Netscape, Mosaic, and Conqueror. There are many others also available. Now, this HTTP is the driving force behind the World Wide Web. So, when we talk about the World Wide Web, when you talk about web server, it is the HTTP protocol we are talking about. So, the web server is running a program which is understanding the HTTP protocol. Any client can send an HTTP request, it will get back an HTTP response or reply. So let us see what this HTTP request and responses look like. So first, let us try to understand HTTP. The Hypertext Transport Protocol, transfer protocol, this is a protocol which the web clients, which the browsers are typical examples of web clients, interact with web servers. This is the language using which a browser and a web server talk among themselves. The Hypertext Transfer Protocol, the first version at least, it is a stateless protocol. Stateless protocol means no history is maintained. Every time a request is sent, a fresh connection has to be established. Okay, if you are requesting for three documents from the same server, you have to establish connection three times, not that you are connecting only once and transferring three documents at the same time. There are of course some subsequent versions of HTTP which allows the so called persistent connections, where you can make multiple transactions over a single connection. This HTTP transfers hypertext across the internet. See, the documents that are stored in the web page, as I said, they are some pages with links to other pages. Okay, these are called hypertexts. So, hypertext is a text with links to other documents. So, this HTTP protocol allows transfer from one document to another using this hypertext. By clicking a link, you can go to some other place. There should be a mechanism inbuilt in the HTTP protocol which should support this kind of a thing. Now, as I had mentioned, browsers and web server communicate using HTTP. The basic steps look like this. The client first opens a socket connection to the HTTP server. Typically, the HTTP server runs over port number 80, but some web servers also run over some other port number, like 8080 or something else also. So, you must know the port number on which the server is running so that you can establish a connection to it. Typically, by default, the port number is 80. So, after connection is established, the client sends HTTP request to the server. Server will send back response and the server will immediately close down connection. This is the stateless mode, where for every connection you are opening and closing the connection. If there is another request, then the whole process will have to repeat it again. Again start a connection, again transact and then close. So, just look at this diagram. Suppose you are sitting here, this is a web client, here you are, here you are using a browser. Here when you are typing the address of a site, say www.yahoo.com, say this is the yahoo.com server. So, an HTTP request is being sent to the yahoo.com server and the server sends back a response which is actually an HTML page which gets displayed on your screen. Now, after the HTML page comes back on your screen, and if you click on one of those so called hyperlinks which links to other documents, then what happens? Now, another HTTP request goes to fetch the other document. The other document possibly is residing on some other web server, and that some other web server will again be sending you back a response, and this will continue. Sending a request, getting back a response, clicking a link, going to some other server, this continue. This is called web browsing, and this browsing can take you from one server to the other across the world. You really do not know that from where you have started and where you will ultimately stop in this process. Now, talking about the HTTP request format, a client request to a server consists of the following. It consists of a request method. There are several request methods we shall be talking about: get, head, post, put, etc. The path portion of the HTTP URL. This URL is a way of specifying the path. We shall be talking about URL later in the lecture. Version number of the HTTP protocol. And for some of the request methods, you may need some optional header information. And in case you need to supply some additional data, the data has to be supplied after a blank line in between. This blank line acts as a delimiter between the header portion and the additional data that you are supplying. Some of the request methods like post or put, they need the additional data. But for those methods which do not need the data, that part may not be there. So, let us look at some of the important request methods one by one. Get is the most widely used method. This is the method which is used to fetch a web page from a server. It returns the contents of the specified document. Get can place any parameter that you need in the request header itself. It does not need any additional lines of header information. Like an example is shown here. This is the get command. You're putting some additional information out here, followed by the HTTP version number. You see, the first part of it, CGI bin myscript.cgi, that specifies a path to a particular resource, myscript.cgi. But after that, following this question mark, there is some additional data, role equal to 1264, ampersand sex equal to m. This actually comes from so called forms. Well, we shall be studying forms later when you study HTML in detail. See, form is something like, you have seen many web pages like the search engines where some blank form like place come, where you can type in something and press enter or search, something else comes back. So, whatever you are typing in those boxes, empty boxes, and placing enter, you are actually filling up a form and submitting it. When the data goes back to the web server, it goes in this form. For example, there was one space for roll number, one space for sex. I have typed in 1, 2, 3, 4 and m, and this is what which goes. Okay. This is the data you get filling, you basically fill up in the form. And the way this roll number equal to ampersand, this is called URL encoding. This we shall study in detail when you talk about CGI scripting and HTML forms later in course of this lecture. But this example shows how we can give this kind of information along with a get command. Now, a very simple illustration of get, where you are trying to retrieve a simple document, no sending of form data, a simple document. See, to start with it, you can just open a command window again and you can start this transaction. You can give a command telnet, you can give the name of a server to which you want to connect, and HTTP. You can either give HTTP or you can give the default port number 80, whatever. This HTTP will mean that the default port number of the HTTP protocol. Well, after this connection is done, you will get back a screen with nothing displayed, which means that the server is expecting you to type something. So, you type a command like this. Get is the request method, slash test.html is the document you are requesting, and this is the version of the HTTP. The server will be sending back a response like this. First, you see there are several lines of header. HTTP, the HTTP version name of the server, it is running 1.1 version, date, server type, last modified, this document, when was it last modified, accept ranges, of course this is an option, I will talk about it later, content length, what is the size of the document, connection close means this is the default approach, that means after the transaction is over, you terminate the HTTP connection. This is the so called stateless approach that I was talking about. So, instead of close, you can also specify connection keep alive, that is supported in the HTTP version 1.1, where you can leave the connection open by default. Okay. And after this, after these lines come this content type, this is a text of type HTML. Here there is a blank line, you see there is a blank line in between. This blank line indicates, or it acts as a delimiter, that now the actual data follows. So, the actual content of the file follows after this. This is a very simple HTML file which was created to give you this demonstration. So, the content of the HTML file will come after that. So, you see that this command, get command, can be used to fetch an HTML file from a server, if you know of course the name of the file. There is another request method called head, which returns only the header information. Well, you may not be interested to get the whole file, but you may need some information about the file, like the file size, when was it last modified, server version, etc. So, a typical session with head will look like this. After doing the telnet, you send a command like this, head name of a file followed by HTTP version. You get back only the header portion. What is missing is actually the body or the contents of the file that you are not requesting here. You are requesting only the header portion. So, only the header portion is coming back to you, and you can have a look at the header portion to see what it contains. If for example, this file size is 1494 bytes, okay, fine. Post is another request method. Post is again another method which is used in conjunction with the submission of the form. So, we will be talking about post now, but you can actually put it in a proper context when we discuss CGI script later during our class. Now, this post is used to send some additional data to the server to be processed, typically by a CGI script. CGI script is a program. CGI stands for Common Gateway Interface. It is a program which is running on the server side. Whenever you fill up a form, typically the data submitted in a form goes to the CGI script. The CGI script reads the data, does some processing, and generates some output which comes back to your client on the browser. It gets displayed there. This is how CGI scripts work. Now, this post request method allows you to send data to the CGI script, but the way this data is sent is different from the GET approach that we had discussed. This uses two additional header types, content type and content length. The requested object is not a resource to retrieve, rather it is a script, an executable script. Similarly, the server response which comes back is not a static file, but rather it is the output of the CGI program which I am saying. So, the server is not sending you back the contents of a file which is already there, rather it is sending you back the output of the CGI program, for instance, which is receiving the data, executing it and sending back the output to you. Okay. Now, the post command can be illustrated with this simple example. Well, again after telnet, suppose you give a command like this, post followed by a path name. This cgi bin slash myscript.cgi, this does not refer to a document or a resource which you want to download. Rather, this is the name of a program, the CGI script program, for instance, which you want to execute whenever this post command is given. And this is the additional information you will also have to supply after post. See, in GET or head, you give a one line command and a lot of response comes back, but in post you will have to give a multiple line command. This post is the first line followed by from, you have to identify yourself from where you are sending, user agent, the name or the version of the user agent that is running on your machine, content type, what type of content it is, well, application something, XWW form URL encoded, these are URL encoded. See, this is the actual content. The way this has been encoded, this is called URL encoding, and the name is XWW form URL encoded, and content length, the total size is 32. There is a blank line between, followed by the actual body of the this additional information. So in GET, this information is put on the same line after a question mark. In POST, it is put as part of the command after a blank line. Now, in POST, you can put as much material as you can. So, if you have a lot of data to send, POST is the preferred approach, because in GET, the total size of that string is limited by usually 256, the maximum size of the string that the machine can support. Some other request method, put is used to upload the contents of a web page. It replaces the contents of the specified document with the data supplied along with the command. So, here the data that you are supplying, this you can supply exactly like the post command. So after some initial header, give a blank line, then give your entire web page which you want to upload. So the entire thing will be the data you are trying to send to the server. The server will handle it and it will be uploading it. But of course, as you can understand, not all web servers allow you uploading facility. Only a few web server will allow you to do that, and of course only after proper authentication. Delete is similar in the sense that this also makes updation. This can delete a specified document. This also is not used very widely. Only in some servers where you have proper authentication you can do that. And after sending the request, well, there is some request header, you see, that means when you are sending the request, some request header informations are required. Now after the initial line, get, post, put, etc. So a client can send any number of header lines. Some of these we have illustrated with the example for post. So after the post command, there were several additional lines of header followed by the data that were supplied. So this is usually optional. For some request types like get, you do not need it. For some others you need. Some of the common header types are accept. This accept followed by a string indicates that which MIME types the client will accept. Connection. Connection is the connection type. If it is close, you are asking it to close connection after every transaction. If it is keep alive, then you are saying that, well, it will not be stateless. You let the connection be persistent. I can send more than one file, one transaction over that open connection. So you can specify this as part of the header. Content length, of course, you have seen number of bytes of data. Content type, what MIME type of data is there. There is a pragma header, pragma colon followed by no cache. This indicates that if you are redirecting your command to a proxy server, you are saying that you please do not send me my requested information from your cache. You try to send me a fresh copy from the original server. So this pragma no cache tells you to return a fresh document. Well, although a cached copy may exist, you may want sometime that you want the latest updated copy from the original server. And for commands which requires request data like the post and put, so you will have to put a blank line followed by the actual data. So there will be the initial header followed by a blank line, then the data part. This will be the structure of your overall HTTP request. Okay. Now after the request is sent, now it is time to get back the responses. So the responses look similar. The requests, for most of them other than get, there are some standard request headers followed by optional data. The responses also look very similar. There will be an initial response line, which is also called the status line, response status line. It consists of three parts: the HTTP version, a 3-digit response code, and an English phrase indicating what type it is. Two examples are shown. It will either be HTTP version name 200 OK or version name 404 not found. This 200, 404 are the error codes, and OK and not found are the error types. And after this initial status line will come the actual content of the response. There will be some header at the beginning followed by the actual data, and again as usual there will be a blank line in between. So there will be a blank line separating them. So the header looks very much like the HTTP request line. There will be some header types followed by the value, like content length, connection close, content type, and at the end you will get the data that you are requesting. And the 3-digit status codes, they indicate anything starting with 1 indicates that this is only for information. This is not an error message. You need not have to do anything special with respect to this. This is just for your information, some informational message. 2, anything starting with 2 indicates successful transaction. Anything starting with 3 indicates that you have been redirected to another URL. Some servers support redirection. Starting with 4 means some error condition. 5 means there is some internal server error. So, this kind of errors are reported by error code which is starting with these initial digits. Some of the common status codes are like this: 200 means OK, 301 means some document you're requesting has been moved permanently, 302 means temporarily, 401 there is some authorization problem, maybe you have not supplied the password correctly, 403 some document, some access permissions are not there, 404 not found, 500 some server error. Okay. Now, in the response header there are several things which are included. Like content length, you already know, it specifies the size of the data in bytes. Content type, again MIME type and subtype, what kind of data is coming. Date means the current date. Well, each document that resides on the server can also have something like an expiry date associated with it. So, whenever you are fetching a document, it will also contain what is the expiry date. Some document may contain expired date, some document may not contain. If it contains, then you will have a look at the expired date and find out whether this is an obsolete document or not. There is a last modified, the name is obvious what it means. And set cookie. Set cookie is another information which is sometimes sent back. See, set cookie followed by some name value pair. See, whenever you want to have cookie in your browser, cookie has some values, name and value pair, which are sent from the other side, which can be used by your browser to do some kind of local processing. Like when you are maintaining a session, you use cookies. You maintain some information about the session, some session ID. You continuously check whether your present session variable matches with the session ID stored in the cookie. If not, you give an error message that your session has expired, something like that. So, this cookie can also be sent back. And after the initial header, again there will be a blank line which will be followed by the actual data. So, the way the requests are sent and the responses are sent back are very similar. They use the MIME format for the heading, a blank line then followed by the data. There is no upper limit to the data size, it can be very big also. The two versions of HTTP which you see around you today, this HTTP 1.0 was the older version, but most of the modern web servers use the later version 1.1. Now, in 1.0 the server typically closes connection after completing a transaction, that is the default, while in 1.1 the server keeps the connection open, it is persistent. So, it depends on the scenario that you are working in, whether you want to keep it persistent or not. See, for servers which are very heavily used, keeping a connection persistent will add the load on the server, because every machine has a maximum limit to the number of connections that it can handle simultaneously. So, if it is a persistent connection and there are many connections which are coming and remaining, you can say active for a long time, it may so happen that the maximum limit may reach, and after that requests which are coming, they will not be honored, they will be denied. So, for most servers which are pretty popularly used, they prefer to use stateless or non-persistent connection type. Now, HTTP version 1.1, let us try to see in what way this is different from the HTTP 1.0. See, HTTP version 1.1 has become an IETF draft standard as early as in 2001. So, details about this version is available on the net. Now, the improvements that have taken place over HTTP version 1.0 are, this version requires a mandatory host identification. See, what is meant is that in the conventional GET command in version 1.0, you needed only a single line, but in version 1.1 you also need an additional line after that, host colon followed by the domain name of the server. What does this mean? Suppose I want to get a document from a server, I give a GET command, next line I give following the host type of the header type, I follow it with the name of the server. But you can argue that, well, anyway I am establishing a connection to the server either by using an explicit telnet or by typing the address on the browser. So, why do I have to specify the name of the server again? See, this is required for some of the server types which we see around us today. These are called multi-homed servers. Multi-home server means there is a single machine, but more than one domain reside on them. Like, what I mean to say is that there is a single server computer, but on the same computer there is one domain name xyz.com, there is another domain name, say for example abc.com, both are residing. So, whenever I am sending a request to that computer, I must identify that which of the two servers I am actually trying to send my request to. So, for this purpose explicit server identification is required, and of course there has to be a blank line after that and then enter. Okay. Default support for persistent connection, this I have already mentioned. So, that by default multiple transactions take place over a single connection, but if you want you can make the connection type as close and you can make it as stateless. Support for content negotiation, like see, you can have several alternate representations. This may be with respect to the browser, this may be with respect to the server also. So, you can negotiate and find out which of these are the best among the available ones. This may be driven by the server, this may be driven by the browser. Like, you are looking for a document, the document may be presented to you in one of several formats. Possibly the browser can give a preference that, well, I prefer the document in HTML. Well, if it is not possible for you to give in HTML, give me in some other PDF format, like that. So, these are some preferences which has to be negotiated, and this can be negotiated based on some initiative made by the browser or also the server, both are possible. Now, one interesting thing which HTTP version 1.1 supports, which is not there in 1.0, is that browsers can request part of the document. See, earlier what happened, say for example, when you are accessing the net, you are clicking on a link and some file was being downloaded. Suppose it was a big file. Now, in between, if due to some error, if the connection got broken, then again if you have to resume the connection, you have to start from the beginning, because ultimately request for the document has to go as an HTTP request, that I want that document. But in this new feature, what has been incorporated is that you can specify that I want this document, but you start sending me this document from this particular offset. Maybe a part of this document I already have with me, I want to start downloading from this particular point. This helps in saving a lot of time for download. This can be done by using the range header type by specifying bytes. Like an example, range colon bytes equal to 1200-350. This means that I want to fetch only byte number 1200 up to 3500. Browsers can ask for more than one range, there can be several such range lines. This, as I mentioned, this allows us to continue with interrupted downloads. Okay. The HTTP version 1 allows efficient caching support. This is another feature which has been added. So, this supports a document caching model that allows both the server and the client to control that to what extent you need to maintain the cache. See, when you say I am maintaining cache, there are a number of things. What is the size of the cache? Up to how many days I will maintain information in the cache? What is my cache architecture? A lot of things can be negotiated upon. So, using this caching support through some specific headers, the client and the server can negotiate and fix up exactly what kind of caching you desire. See, earlier the caching architecture was fixed statically, but here it can be negotiated upon and you can fix upon an architecture. But in order to have all these facilities working, HTTP 1.1 obviously require several extra things from both client and server. Just one example I have just given, that explicit host identification is required. After the get command, the client must also send that extra host command. So, if you are writing a new client today, you must keep this in mind, you must incorporate this in your architecture. So, just to have a quick look at what are the different features you need to have. Suppose you are going ahead with the design of an HTTP 1.1 client. So, what are the new requirements you must have? First, as I said, the explicit host identification is required. You must include the host header with each request. Well, persistent connection is supported by default, but if you want to have the other stateless transaction, then you must have this connection clause option specified in the header explicitly. There are some other features also, I am not going into detail, but you can have a look at the HTTP documentation and try to find out what these are. There is 100 continued response and there is something called chunked data, which is also sometimes useful when you are sending a number of different things together. So, these are the kind of supports you must have from the client if you want to have an HTTP 1.1 compatible client, which can faithfully talk to an HTTP 1.1 server and communicate. Similarly, from the point of view of the server, there are a few things the server must also do. Like, it will require a host header from the client, it should accept absolute URLs in a request, because most of the earlier servers, they only accepted relative URLs. The absolute URL means you start from the root http://hostname/path, the complete path, that is absolute URL. Then accept request with chunk data, this again you can have a look what is chunk data. Include the date header in each response, this is the additional thing. Support for at least get and head are mandatory, but others you can keep depending on the environment in which you want to use this. And in order to have backward compatibility, you should also support 1.0 HTTP requests and either support persistent connection or include connection close header request explicitly in the request. Okay. So, if due to some reason persistent connection cannot be supported by the server, then connection colon close, this must explicitly be present in the headers of every response you generate, so that the clients will know that, well, this particular server cannot support persistent, so let me go for non-persistent. Okay. So, talking about HTTP proxy server, we will be talking about proxy servers in more detail later. Proxy server is basically an interface between a client and a server. Say here you have a proxy server, you have the client out here, you have the server out here. So, client sends the request to the proxy server proxy server sends the request to the server. The server, when it sends back the request, request goes to the proxy sends the request back to the client. So, proxy works more like a middleman, proxy sits in between, but what does actually proxy do? Well, the proxy has a number of other features that we shall talk about later. It can provide some kind of authentication, it can provide some kind of filtering, some kind of simple firewall configuration it can implement. There are a few other things. The proxy server will receive requests from the client on one side and it will forward them to the server on the other side. Similarly, when the response comes back, responses come back from the server and they are forwarded to the client. So, you can say that the proxy at the same time is acting both as HTTP client as well as HTTP server. So, whenever it is receiving request from the client, so on one side it is receiving request from the client, it is acting as a server. On the other side, it is forwarding that same request to the web server, at that time it is acting as the client. So, I just mentioned proxy server here because proxy server is an example where you need to have both the functionalities of HTTP client and server in the same software package, software tool or software program. So, the details of the proxy server we shall see later, but the point I wanted to emphasize is this, that this is one example of a program where if you want to code, you must have both the functionalities of the server and client in it. Okay. So, and another thing about proxy server is that the request from a client to a proxy server is a little different from normal server. Why? Because in a normal web server, what you do? You establish a connection, then you specify the path name of a document. Okay? So, the server knows that, well, a connection has already been established with me, I have this path name. So, I can locate the particular file on this path and I can send it back to the requesting client. But in a proxy server, the situation is different. Here every request must contain the complete path along with the name of the machine, which means the complete URL, well, I will come back to this URL shortly. Complete URL means complete path starting from the name of the machine along with the document. Say for example, www.xyz.com/docs/abc.txt, because the proxy server will have to forward this request to some other server. If it does not know which server the request is going to, how will it do that? If it was just a relative URL, relative path name, then it would not know where to forward the request to. Okay? So, that is why a request coming to a proxy server must be coming in a complete way. So, that you will see that in most of the browsers, there is a facility for specifying proxy server. You can specify that that request from your browser will go through a proxy server. You specify the name or the IP address on and the port number in which the proxy server is working. The way the browser will behave is that whenever it is trying to send something to the proxy server, it will send the complete path name to the proxy server, so that it can handle. Okay. Now, let us finally talk about the uniform resource locators or URL. See, URL are nothing but mechanisms to locate some resource on the internet. In the simple case, I want to locate a particular file on the web server. That is the example of a URL. Okay? So, URL is the short form for uniform resource locator. So, as I had mentioned, this URL is a mechanism or it is a format, whatever you call, by which documents or resources can be addressed in the internet, in the World Wide Web. I mean, a URL contain several information. First, of course, the name or the address of the site or the server where the actual resource you are trying to address is located. Secondly, what is the type of service you want to use to access the resource. Do we want to use FTP? Do we want to use HTTP or something else? Port number of the service. Well, in most cases some default port number is assumed, but you can explicitly specify a port number also. And once you have located or you have specified everything, you may also specify a path name on the server which specifies where the resource is located on that particular server. So, all these things taken together will actually identify where the server will actually, where the particular resource you are trying to address is actually located on the server. Now, let us see what are the different URL types. I will illustrate with examples without going into detail. This URLs are nothing but a form of specifying internet addresses. So, the whatever you have specified, it starts with this scheme, this is the syntax, scheme which access method you are using, followed by a colon double slash. Well, there is one example where you do not need this double slash, followed by the address of the machine. This colon port is optional. If you want to specify an explicit port number, give colon port followed by a path name. Some examples follow. The first example is a URL which says it is an HTTP, this is the name of the server and this is the path of the resource. The resource is ab1.html. The second one is also HTTP, but it specifies an explicit port number. Here the HTTP server is running on port number 2345. The resource is rows.jpg in this path. The third is an example of an email, mail to. At the end you have the email address. Well, if you have this mail to URL as part of a web page, if you click on it, automatically a mail window will open where you can type in a mail. This is the reason why mail to URL is required. News is one example where double slash is not required. This refers to news groups. FTP is for file transfer. In the first case, after the slash you give the username, colon, you give the password, then this at the rate sign, then the machine where you want to do an FTP, then this is the path name where the document or resource is located. The last example refers to anonymous FTP where username password are not given. So, if the username password are missing, then by default it is taken to be anonymous FTP, and this is the address of the machine and this is the address of the document or resource under the anonymous directory. And this URL can also be used to send a query string, like the example that we had given earlier for GET. Well, GET is a way to send it as an HTTP string, but even when you type an URL on the browser, there also you can explicitly specify that. Like an example follows, it says HTTP, this is the name of the machine, this is the path name of the resource. Here this path name refers to a CGI script program again, a question mark followed by some additional information. Now, this whole thing is a URL, this you can type on a browser and press enter. What the browser will do, it will generate a GET HTTP request from this and it will send it to the requested server. So, actually what will go to the server will be the same GET request as I had mentioned earlier, but this is how you can also specify it in an URL as part of HTTP. So, with this we come to the end of this first part of our discussion on World Wide Web. Now, let us quickly have a look at the answer to the questions that were posed in our last class, solution to the quiz questions on lecture 9. What are the basic drawbacks of SMTP? Well, in SMTP the main drawback is that this SMTP cannot send non-text messages. For this purpose you need MIME, and error reporting is not guaranteed. These are the basic drawbacks. Number 2, which port number do SMTP servers use for accepting client requests? This is port number 25. Why does MIME does not have any port number associated with it? Well, as I said, MIME is not a server. What happens is that suppose this is MIME, this is your SMTP. So, MIME actually translates a document into an alternate form and gives it to SMTP. It is the SMTP server which is actually sending the mail, and it is the SMTP which is acting, which is residing as a server program. Okay? So, this MIME is not a server, it is a simple translator. So, under what condition can SMTP server also act as a mail client? This I mentioned, when an intermediate SMTP node is doing mail forwarding, receiving a mail from one server and forwarding it to another, then it is simultaneously acting as mail receiver and mail sender, both client and server. What are the purpose of the mail from and receive to commands in SMTP? Mail from will identify who is sending the mail, receive to will identify to whom you are sending the mails. What is the difference between CC and BCC in the SMTP header? See, CC and BCC both are used to send copies of the mail to some other people. For example, your primary destination may be somebody, you are sending copies of the mail to someone else. If you use CC, suppose the mail was destined to me, when I receive the mail, I can also see that, well, this mail was also copied to these fellows. But if you specify those copies using BCC or blind carbon copies, CC means carbon copy, BCC means blind carbon copy, then the final recipient will not know that to whom the copies were sent to. Okay, that is why it is blind. Why is IMAP preferred over POP3? Because in IMAP there are some additional features, like you can check the email headers, you can search the mail contents, you can manage user mailbox. So, these are the main extra features. A message has 3000 bytes, you are encoding it using base64, what will be the size of the encoded message? Now, in base64, if you recall, every 24 bit of the message gets encoded in 32 bits. So, the total size will be 4000 bytes. Is it mandatory for DNS server to run on same machine as SMTP? No, DNS can run on any other machine. Whenever you configure your computer, you have to specify the address of the DNS server. So, whenever there is a name involved, the DNS server will be automatically queried and the IP address obtained from there. How are mail attachments handled in MIME? Mail attachments are separated by using the boundary strings. MIME headers will be associated with each attachment. For example, your mail has two attachments. Okay? There will be two such attachments with appropriate boundary headers. And in each such attachment, there will be additional headers which will specify what is the type of attachment, whether it is an image, it is an audio file, video file, what it is, and how they are encoded. Is the encoding technique base64 or something else? Okay. Now, some questions from today's lectures. Why is the traditional HTTP protocol called stateless? What is a hypertext? What is the default port number of HTTP? What does the client request to a HTTP server comprise of? How can the GET command be used to submit forms? What is the purpose of the HET command? In what way is POST different from GET when data is being sent to a CGI script? How are the data sent in POST command? What are the connection field in the HTTP request header signify? What does a typical HTTP response consist of? What are the basic differences in the HTTP 1.1 version from the 1.0 version? How does a proxy server act both as a client and a server? What is the URL syntax for FTP? So, with this we stop today's lecture. In our next lecture, we shall be talking about some other aspect of World Wide Web, subsequent to which we will be talking about how we can design web pages using various technologies like HTML, ASP and so on. Thank you. We will be continuing with a discussion on World Wide Web. Now, if you recall, in our last class we were talking about the HTTP protocol, and I had mentioned that this HTTP protocol provides the heart of the World Wide Web. All transactions that go over the internet today, whenever a client wants to contact a web server and the responses are sent back, they are done through the HTTP protocol. So, today we will be continuing our discussion from there. So, World Wide Web part 2 is the topic of our discussion today. So, we start with by looking at the requirements of a web server. For example, if someone asks you to design a web server, so we try to address the issues that would be faced by you as a designer. What are the things that needs to be taken care of? So, let us look at the basic requirement of a web server first. Now, of course, the most basic of the requirements is that your web server must be able to accept HTTP requests, because our web is based or works on the basis of the HTTP protocol. So, the first point is absolutely mandatory. And for the majority of requests, the request type will be either GET, where you are possibly trying to fetch a web page, or HEAD, where you are trying to fetch the information about a page. And if you are supporting forms, then possibly also POST. There are other HTTP commands also, you recall, but these three are the most basic. There are PUT, DELETE, this kind of commands are also there, but these three are the most basic ones. There is another form of NAT which is perhaps the most popular. This is called overloading. This in a sense is a special form of dynamic NAT, because addresses are not assigned statically to the computers. They are somehow access permissions are generated dynamically. This again is used to map multiple unregistered IP addresses to a single registered IP addresses. See, here there is a difference. You have a single registered address, not multiple as I was discussing in the previous case. There is a single valid IP address available with me, but I can support 100 simultaneous requests from the private network. How I can do this? I can do this by using the port numbers.